Today on Typical Books, we're going to talk about some new books coming out from Horror Writers Association authors. Yes. First things first, though, I want to say good luck to all that are in the nomination run for Bram Stoker Awards this season. It's coming up this weekend. I'm going to be attending virtually, so come hang out. There's a lot of authors that will be attending in person in Denver, Colorado, and a lot online as well, alongside me and a lot of other non-members, because their non-members are allowed to go to StokerCon, right? I'm going to be checking that out, and I'm going to have my fingers crossed. I'm going to be throwing salt over my shoulder. I'm going to be knocking on wood all weekend long, because Tide Pool is up in the running for best debut novel, and there was actually a tie in the top five that they take for nominations for the final ballot. There was a tie, and there are some very interesting books in that category, so it will be a very close race. Another close race is best novel, and that one is coming down to the Grady Hendrix Final Girl Support Group, and of course, which is probably a lot of people's pet favorite, the Stephen Graham Jones, My Heart is a Chainsaw. I haven't read either book because I'm a horrible horror fan. Like, yeah, we all know this. I miss out on a lot of new books and typically read them later. This is why the patron poll is so important to me, because it makes me buy new books, because I always like neglect buying new books. Those are two that I neglected to buy. I have one on Kindle and the other I'm waiting to find in hardcover. So yeah. Anyway, those are in the running, and I know it's going to be a really, 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 really tight race. People will be live tweeting it as usual every single year. There's a lot of people live tweeting the results, so you can catch up there or follow along by watching when it streams on Saturday evening. Also, before I get into the books, there are 11 books, I think 12, 11, something like that, a lot, because I neglected to do this through April. I'd done a video for books come out in March, and then I looked at this list and thought, why is it so long? Oh yeah, because I forgot to do a video for new books coming out from Horror Writers authors in April. So this will have some April, May, and some older books too. And speaking of older books, when I did my last haul, I forgot that I went to Barnes & Noble. We don't have Barnes & Noble here. We have Chapters in Canada. They're very, very similar. The layout is pretty much the same, and you can even get a Starbucks in both locations. So it's very similar. So it wasn't like, it didn't stick out in my mind, like going to Second and Charles or my now famous Apport Books. Thank you to watchers who have gone and shopped at Apport Books, by the way. Thank you for supporting a small indie bookstore that I now love, my number one favorite bookstore. But yeah, I picked up some books. Stephen King's A Girl Who Loved Tom Gordon. This isn't something that I wanted to pick up because it's got a sport person and it has sport stuff in it, and I'd been really turned off by that. This is the girl that calls the town Jim Thorpe Mock Chunk, its old name, because it's named after a sport person, because I'm that big of a elitist jerk when it comes to disliking sports. But yeah, I'm going to read it because it's thin and it's a hardcover and it's in really good condition, so it was on for a good special too. So yeah, Girl Who Loved Tom Gordon by Stephen King. Susan Hill's The Woman in Black, classic. I'd never owned a copy, so I picked up this decent, very pretty little copy of it. I'd read it before we covered it on Dead Air. We covered the movie, so I read the book before we did the movie, but I'll definitely read it again. It's a very nice fall read. I think that's what I'll read for Halloweenathon, perhaps. I have an incendiary read, something I've seen a lot of mixed reviews, Gretchen Felker-Martin's Manhunt. And I love the cover. I loved the cover when it first came out. I don't know why I dragged my feet on buying this, but yeah, it remains to be seen. This sounds like it could be right up my alley. Very interested, because I like the hunting humans trope. I don't know how much it will be stood on its head here, but apparently it is. So yeah, very interested to hear the story of women hunting men. It may run me the wrong way because I'm very much into equal rights, like really seriously equal, cut down the middle equal rights, and taking into account strengths and weaknesses on both sides. So it may rub me the wrong way, but we'll see. I don't know. I have high hopes. And this final book on cover, Appeal Alone. I almost bought it on hardcover, but I wasn't sure, so I waited, and now it's in paperback. Josh Malerman's Goblin. So yes, I finally have picked this up, and I'm going to be checking out this collection of novellas. So that's that. Getting to the books, here are some new releases from Horror Writers Association authors. And as promised, it's quite a girthy list at that. We're starting out with One Hand to Hold, One Hand to Carve by M.Shaw. And this isn't M.Shaw as in Matt Shaw, the splatterpunk author. And it's weird because he had a book out right at about the same time. But this is just M.Shaw. Two halves of a human cadaver awaken on a cold morgue slab. The two distinct personalities, left and right, remember nothing of their previous life as a singular body. Bound by the necessity to carve out an existence on the fringes of society, the two brothers have very different ideas of the life they want. This sounds like it'll be quite surreal, and I'm very interested in One Hand to Hold, One Hand to Carve. This comes from Tenebris Press, by the way. And this next one is also out already. These books are out already. The Mill by Cailyn Lloyd. It comes from Land of Oz. As a psychic, seeing ghosts is a routine for Lily. She isn't surprised to discover spirits lurking in the renovated paper mill where she just bought an apartment. What she doesn't expect is the dark, sinister presence under the floor and the serial killer who is prowling the mill. When a woman is found murdered and another goes missing, Lily tries to work with the spirits, a young, long-dead girl, to expose the psychopath. And I really like this. It sounds like there's quite a lot going on, but it's a one-scene thing, it seems, inside this abandoned paper mill. So, interested to see this with multiple haunts and scary things going on. It has a ghost haunting of some sort, psychic phenomena, and serial killers. Some of my favorite things all in one. And The Haunting of Kinnawe House, which I'm reading right now, from Stephen Rigolosi from Black Rose Writing, a publishing house I'd never heard of. A ghost story that spans two eras in American history tells the story of Matthew Rollins, a singer-songwriter, who is summoned against his will to his ancestral home. As Matthew searches for clues to his father's identity, he increasingly falls under the influence of Kinnawe House, which seeks to rob him of his sanity and his life. And I've learned to pronounce Rigolosi, I think, and Kinnawe House, or Kinnawe House. Two different ways that are explained in the book on how to pronounce, not Kinnawe House. Kinnawe House. Also already out is Devilish Dust by Erik Dean. Between Tucson and Phoenix, several drivers will be trapped in a deadly dust storm. Pull off the road and turn off your lights. That's what the transportation authorities are saying. There's something else they're not telling travelers, but they'll find out soon enough. They'll come face to face with the evil that lurks in the dust storm. So like the mist, but a dust storm. That's how I'm reading it anyway. Devilish Dust. And this book, Spare Parts by Aaron Deck, is out already as well. What nightmare stalks the halls of St. Agnes Hospital? In the catacombs, deep beneath one of Montreal's oldest establishments, something sinister is lurking. Simon and Alicia are caught up in its web, but neither knows who or what is preying on the hospital or how they can avoid becoming the next victims. It takes place in Montreal. I'm already in. I'm very interested. Canadian horror is not, I would say, few and far between. There's a lot more, and there is a Southern Ontario Gothic movement. Wikipedia taught me that. And I've read quite a few titles that are more modern than the ones they include on that list. So maybe I'll do a Southern Ontario Gothic video someday, because it's a thing. I did not know it was a thing. But yeah, Montreal. Montreal. Montreal's beautiful. I haven't spent enough time there. We have a nonfiction book about horror, The Study and Craft by L. Marie Wood, and this comes from Mocha Memoirs Press and is out already. With importance placed on knowing the history of the genre and how integral research is to storytelling, this textbook will serve as a referenceable guide for anyone interested in writing in the horror genre. This work, which is accessible and detailed at the same time, offers practical scenarios and industry secrets alongside subgenre reviews and creative writing instruction. Very interested. Always like to add to my arsenal, and I will add, this is for writers, but readers enjoy this sort of stuff too. Definitely. Do not exclude the readers, right? And reviewers. Very, very important, I think, to read about the thing you love in a nonfiction setting. Another somewhat nonfiction book, Werewolves, Dogmen, and Other Shapeshifters Stalking North America. This is by Pamela K. Kinney from Dream Punk Press. And I do love myself a cryptid. Myths and folklore, even witness sightings of werewolves, the Dogmen, Wendigo, Kastaka, which are Ottermen, skinwalkers, owl witches, and other shapeshifters, creatures stalk us across North America from arid deserts to the dense forest and even farther north to the reaches of Alaska. Well, I'd love to read about these Alaskan cryptids, personally. I like the cover of that book too, quite a bit. Asylum Daughter by Natasha Sinclair. This is out from Clan Witch, which is another publisher I've never heard of. Bella Mills survived the brutal slaughter of her family by a madman at only 11 years old. She was assaulted and left for dead. 23 years later, the past returns in the form of her devil, free from his chains. I'm assuming somebody that has been released or escaped from prison. Terrifying. Somewhat like the stepfather, maybe? Or like Dexter? Like, she's 11 years old, a lot older than Dexter was in Darkly Dreaming Dexter. But yeah, Asylum Daughter, Natasha Sinclair. And that came out this week. Another book out this week. And my list isn't sorted properly, so I'm going to jump back and forth in time a little bit. Killer Be Killed by William Sterling. Boone wants revenge from his sacrificed daughter. Chevre wants revenge against those who botched her summoning ritual. If they both play their cards right, the counselors at Camp Tall Pines are due for the worst night of their lives. Killer Be Killed is a reverse camp slasher novel. The closest thing I can think of is Con Season by Adam Caesar. Remind me quite a bit of that. I had read somebody on Reddit looking for camp slashers, or maybe it was even here on YouTube. Maybe on Alex, the Bookubus videos, someone in comments. Well, there's a camp slasher for you, I think. It's a reverse camp slasher, so maybe it's not slashing at all. Maybe it's just camping. That would be horrible. For me, not for them. So yes, out in February was Beyond the Creek by Nico Bell. When Alex Foster accepted the caregiver position with the eccentric Knox family, she was issued a single warning, don't go beyond the creek. There's something out there waiting for her and it's hungry. So yes, the Beyond the Creek. I have a feeling I've pitched this book before. I'm not sure, like not pitched this book, but had it on the show. I'll have to look back. It just sounds really familiar, but I could be confusing it with a Teddy book. I'll have to look it up. If you can remember what book I'm talking about, let me know. But Beyond the Creek by Nico Bell. I like the cover of this one quite a lot too. And I haven't been talking too much about the cover designs, but this one takes the cake. This one really caught my eye. Bottled Spirits and Other Dark Tales by Adrian Ludens from LVP Publications. And that's Lichen Valley Press. Now the cover makes me think of horror western. And I know that's a very popular subgenre these days. And it talks about a novelette being contained in here, Bottled Spirits, hence the title, Bottled Spirits and Other Dark Tales. So Bottled Spirits is a novelette that is within this book. Longer than a novella, a novelette is. Truman Bonner sets out to rescue his wife, Helena, from ruthless outlaws and personal demons. He and his son, Isaac, face a series of harrowing supernatural ordeals, and before the family is reunited, more than one of them may have made a deal with the devil. These and 10 other macabre tales wait within. So if you like horror westerns, a few of the other ones deal with something like trickster gods, organ harvesting, it seems to be all over. But if you're into horror westerns, say this novelette may offer you what you need. And last on the list, a book that came out just this week, and I'm very interested to check this out, Orphans of Bliss, Tales of Addiction Horror. This is the follow-up to the addiction horror anthology Lullabies for Suffering, which I quite enjoyed. Nothing really stood out, so maybe this will be the one that does what I want a book on addiction horror to do. It's already horrifying. It's supremely horrifying to me personally. So yes, I'm very, very interested in seeing how this turns out. Again, the cover art on Lullabies for Suffering was wonderful. Orphans of Bliss is a gorgeous looking cover. And there is an author of Killian Patrick Burke within this. I wonder if he did the art. But there is many other authors to choose from. Josh Malerman, Cassandra Kaw, Krista Carmen, John F. D. Taff, S.A. Cosby, Samantha Kolesnik, Gambino Iglesias, Kathy Koja, and Mark Matthews. And this is from Wicked Run Press. So yeah, gorgeous, wonderful. Very interested in seeing this wonderful book, and it will be probably in the running next year for Bram Stoker Awards, because I've said this last year as well, a lot of the books that you see here are books that will end up on the ballot. Now of course you don't have to be a Horror Writers Association member to be nominated into the ballot, so you can just be a horror author and not be affiliated with HWA at all. So books that are written by non-members definitely get nominated. And I think that that's really cool. So when I say here that books out by Horror Writers Association authors may end up on the next year's ballot, it's not the only books. There's all sorts of horror books that are written by all sorts of people around the world that can end up on the ballot, of course. It's just if members read them and vote them in. So if you've read any of these new books, definitely let me know in the comments below. And I'll see you at the Bram Stoker Awards, more than likely. Thanks for watching, and have an ooky, spooky day.